Okay. CFD was born a very long time ago, and the main driving force was the Cold War and the space race. Who could get first on the moon? And why it was mainly introduced? Because if you look really at the cost of doing CFD versus doing some wind tunnel testing, or really taking the actual airplane, car, whatever you want to study and do some experiment on it, the cost varies a lot. So 0.5k US dollar for a 1 hour of CFD, then you go up to 10k for a 1 hour in the wind tunnel. And then, 100,000K if you really want to simulate, for instance, a complete airplane. And what I'm going to show here, the first pictures, is the A40, the Airbus 380, one of the newest airplanes from Airbus. And all the stuff that you see over there, they were designed using CFD. So, 20 years ago, that was impossible. You couldn't think about that, right? So now our algorithm became, more accurate. We have high fidelity, and we can redesign part of the airplane that you're using. Using the computer, and then they're validated in the wind tunnel or with the flight test. And down there you see some graph. We show the reduction between this airplane that I show here, the A340, and compared to the Airbus A380, and the other one is the Boeing 787. And there is a 40% of reduction of wind tunnel testing compared to what was done with the 787 and the A380. So one can say, okay, why do we need something else? Okay, if everything is working fine, we can design car, Formula One car, airplane, whatever, with the tools we have, why do we need something else? Well, the reason is very simple, but it's a bit technical. So there are two plots here. The first one on the top right show a straight line, a black line, okay, which is the increase of power that we get. I mean, I'm simplifying really this thing for the people that don't know. The power that we get during the year using a microprocessor, which is a small part of a supercomputer or your laptop. Okay, so that's the increase, keep increasing, and it follows or it, a law which is called a Moore law. I reported the same line in the left bottom graph, which is what you see, Moore law. And then there is another line which is not straight, which is going up, and it continues with a red arrow. So basically, that's the demand that we have for computational power, and the other one is what we get from computer. So even though we're going to get larger and larger supercomputer, we will not be able to fill this gap. So we have to do something if we really want to do all the simulation which requires, flow around complex geometry like the McLaren car, around an airplane, simulate combustion, whatever you want to do, okay? So, here it's a slide which is connected to what many people are talking about. So I said the computer, the power of the computer are increasing, we get more and more power from them. But even though we will reach in few years, the so-called exascale era. So, for instance, we will get 5,000 petaflop per second. That means that we can do 5,000 billion of operation per second. Okay, that's a lot, okay? But it will not be enough to satisfy our need to design better and better, device. So, especially when you have complex geometry, multi-physics, when you say multi-physics, you mean you have combustion, for instance, interaction between, some solid wall that are moving, that are flexible, things of this type. And, Formula One car, the McLaren car is, one of these challenging problems that you're facing. So, the answer that we can we fill this gap, and the answer is yes. Okay, so CFD lies how we can do that. So if you look at CFD, computational fluid dynamics, like an intersection of mathematics, physics, engineering, because we try to solve practical problems, and also high performance computing, extreme computing. That's for instance what we do in the center and part of the extreme computing center here at KAUST. So, but what we need to have, together with the supercomputer, it's also more advanced algorithm that we use to solve our problem. So if you have a problem, this is described by some physical law, most likely by some partial differential equation, for the people who know what I'm talking about, and those are the continuous level. When you want to take them, and you want to talk with your computer and say, okay, look, I want to solve them, you have to discretize them first. Then you code them, and then the computer can understand them. But the process of discretizing them requires some algorithm. And this algorithm, we cannot use the algorithm we have nowadays. We can still use them to solve some problem, but we need to come up with new algorithm with better properties if we really want to achieve what I described before. And my answer is not, you know, flying in the sky. I mean, if you look at the history of computational fluid dynamics, during the 80s and the 90s, we got about, you know, 10 to 6 fold improvement in computational power. But the same amount of power or, you know, efficiency was also taken, we obtained from developing new algorithms. So what I'm saying is not new, okay? It has been done in the 80s, in the 90s. Why we cannot do it now? So the focus of my research and the partnership with McLaren is to advance these algorithms, take them and apply it to a real laboratory, which is really the Formula One car. So what I said probably seems to be complicated. Everything even gets even harder when you go and you look at, you know, the aerodynamic of a Formula One car. So why it's so complicated? Because the aerodynamic of Formula One car is, you know, it's very advanced. I would say that it, I probably it's the most advanced aerodynamic, you know, object that I know, even more than probably, you know, commercial airline. Maybe it's at the level of, you know, fighting aircraft, something of this, but probably it's a little bit more. And so people, I mean, aerodynamicists, both experimentalists or computational aerodynamicists, they really spend a lot of time, and the company spend a lot of money to improve the aerodynamic of this car, okay? Just to, you know, improve a fraction of a second, you know, the time that you take to do a lap, okay? So we are really talking about small changes in the aerodynamic would give small, you know, performance development, but some all together, they might give, you know, the time that you need, you know, to win the race, maybe. And we have, they have, and now we have to work also considering all the strict FIA regulation. FIA is the, you know, entity that, you know, regulates the Formula One car, and so put rules and check them constantly. So another thing that is, you know, a bit of complicated, I also learned in the past when we started partnership with them, is that, you know, for different track, you know, the setup, the dynamic setup of car might change. So for instance, if I consider the Malaysian track where you have fast turning, there you really want a down force which push your car probably down so you can take it the curve and the turn more faster. And then you also have long straight. So in that case, you really want to reduce the drag. The drag is the force that, you know, is pulling you behind. If you start walking, you will not reach the speed of light. At a certain point, you reach a maximum velocity, which is, you know, the balance between the force you put forward and the drag that puts you backward. So that's the same for any object that is flying in the air, in water, in any liquid. So what do we do to tackle this problem? So if you look in literature, there is, you know, a huge, an impetus wave of people that start to work on high-order scheme, robust high-order scheme, because these get along very well with the new architecture, with the new supercomputer that we have here and that we get in the future. Okay, so my focus, my research is basically on a robust high-order upper scheme for unstructured grid. So unstructured grid because we really need to mesh the geometry of this complicated device like a Formula One car. That's why we talk about unstructured grid. Here is just an example of, you know, a very simple geometry of a test case that we have run. So it's a cylinder at a certain Reynolds number. So the Reynolds number RE define, you know, the properties of your flow. If it's, you know, a very, very small number, then the flow is well behaved, it orders very well. So if it's higher, most likely you're going to get some turbulence, so the flow becomes crowded. Okay, and what I'm showing here is basically the vorticity, which describes the vortices in the flow. And if you see on the right bottom pictures, we have experimental data taken from a wind tunnel, and the computations we have done with our solver, which is an 8-order accurate solver, and there is an extremely good match. So this is a very simple geometry. So the next one is called, so what you really want when you solve your problem, you don't know the solution, right? So otherwise we wouldn't compute anything. So what we do, what we would like to have, we would like to have, you know, a solver, something like a code that runs on a supercomputer, which adapts itself based on the flow feature that you have in your flow. So you don't need a solution. You start off with some, you know, mesh, some discretization, and then you let your solver to be smart enough to refine the accuracy of your numerical solution in a region where, you know, you have flow features that you are interested in. Like in this case, you have a jet coming out from a nozzle. It goes in a still air, and you know, all these vortices are moving. And what you see in the picture, in the movie down, is basically the how it changed the accuracy of my solver during the time by following, you know, the vortices that are generated from this flow. So this is essential if you really want to solve complex problem for which you don't know the solution, and so your solver has to be smart enough to track them down. And so, like making a zoom, that is all better and better this flow feature. This is what it does. So this is another test case. You know, it's a transitional flow, so the flow behaves from a very, you know, ordered to a chaotic one, and you will see now the transition. So it breaks down and you have turbulence. And what I want to show here is that we have a reference solution which is computed by, you know, several people, and it's published in the literature. And we are computing the solution with our 12 order scheme, and there is an excellent match between the lift coefficient and the drag coefficient. So the lift coefficient is a number that tells you how much force you have in the vertical direction. So when you fly with an airplane, you have a force that, you know, keep the airplane up. And then the other one is the drag, the force that pulls you down backwards. So here is another example, just to show, you know, that if you increase the accuracy of your solver, you have to pay something. You don't have free lunch. Okay, if you increase the accuracy, somehow you have to put more energy in solving your problem. What I'm showing here with the red dot and with the red circle and the blue circle is basically that we go from a certain order scheme to a higher order scheme. Basically, we get, you know, we use the same amount of time to get a solution, but we get a better accurate solution. So in the next few slides, I'm going to link what we do here and the partnership that we start with McLaren. Okay, so we had to start somehow in a soft way and show them the capability of our solver and show them that we can actually achieve the accuracy and the level of accuracy and the timing to compute the solution. So what they usually do at McLaren when they start to use a new solver is to solve a set of test cases, okay, and look at the solution, how fast I can get that solution and how accurate is that solution. So we also started from there. So our first long-term goal, it's very long, is to get a solver which is, you know, accurate and significantly faster compared to the conventional software and open source software that they are currently using in their company. Short-term goal is to look at the delta wing, where the flow features are very similar to what you might see on a front wing and plate of the Formula One car, a lot of vortices which break down. There might be transition between laminar flow and turbulent flow. So that's, you know, the first test case there on the corner, left corner, the nozzle. That's a delta wing in a wind tunnel. Then we will be moving to a more advanced test case, which is the Imperial College front wing, and finally we will reach the stage of simulating really the complete front wing and plate of McLaren. So we have already started to work on that, and we did some, you know, scalability study. For the people who don't know what I'm talking about, basically, suppose that you have a computer, if you have a problem, and you solve it with using just, let's say, one computer, one processor, okay? And that is gonna take 1 hour. Then what you want to do, okay, I want to use two computers, two processors to solve the same problem. So if everything works fine, it should take half an hour, right? I double the number of computers, I should half the time that I use to take this solution, okay? So this is what these blocks are describing. If you can see in the left one, there is a number, 91%, okay? That tells that the code that we are using basically has an efficiency of 91%. The maximum that you can get, it's 100%. Sometimes you can shoot over that, but you know there are some simple explanations. So 100% is the maximum. We reach 91%, close to something like 100,000 core. So the code that we are using, because it's based on high order scheme, it behaves very well. So we can use efficiently our supercomputer, and so we can pay the electricity bill and be happy about that. So the other one is again a plot which is it's called weak scaling, but it basically tells us more or less the same thing. So this is the first test case that we tackled with McLaren, and it's the flow over a delta wing. So there is a lot of going on. So delta wing are usually used for supersonic flight, but when you look at them at the super subsonic level, they have some flow features that are very interesting to understand, to resolve. And the flow is already complicated enough that if you can show that your solver can capture those flow features, then you are at a good point. So this is just preliminary results. It's the vorticity around this delta wing. So you see that that you have a red region where the flow is more or less no order. There is nothing going on, and then further down when it becomes blue, you see that it becomes chaotic. That is very difficult to resolve, and it's called turbulent transition and then turbulent flow. So here is some comparison between the velocity and profile close to the wing while it's flying compared to the experimental data, which are provided by McLaren, and they were measured at the Technical University of Munich. And we can see that there is a good agreement between the computation and the numerical result. And the same for the pressure coefficient, which is basically going to tell you, what's the pressure in some point on your surface. And this is very relevant for an aerodynamic purpose. And here is the, I think I got it a few days ago. I just want to say that it's not, the car is not burning here. I just on purpose took this color, which show the vorticity of the turbulent flow around the car. Okay, so we can color it in some way. It's like you're taking the car, you inject some wind, you put some color. Okay, and this color will show you how the particle moves inside the flow. Okay, and this is not it's a very simple model. It doesn't have all the details. This is just for us to understand how complicated is to simulate a full Formula One car, because you really have to go and mesh into detail everything if you really want to get the right answer. And awesome. That's it.